الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا قيما لينذر بأسا شديدا من لدنه ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا حسنا ماكثين فيه أبدا وينذر الذين قالوا اتخذ الله ولدا ما لهم به من علم ولا لآبائهم كبرت كلمة تخرج من أفواههم إن يقولون إلا كذبا فلعلك باخع نفسك على آثارهم إن لم يؤمنوا بهذا الحديث أسفا إنا جعلنا ما على الأرض زينة لها لنبلوهم أيهم أحسن عملا وإنا لجاعلون ما عليها صعيدا جرزا أم حسبت أن أصحاب الكهف والرقيم كانوا من آياتنا عجبا إذ أوى الفتية إلى الكهف فقالوا ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا فضربنا على آذانهم في الكهف سنين عددا ثم بعثناهم لنعلم أي الحزبين أحصى لما لبثوا أمدا نحن نقص عليك نبأهم بالحق إنهم فتية آمنوا بربهم وزدناهم هدى وربطنا على قلوبهم إذ قاموا فقالوا ربنا رب السماوات والأرض لن ندعو من دونه إلها لقد قلنا إذا شططا هؤلاء قومنا اتخذوا من دونه آلهة لولا يأتون عليهم بسلطان بين فمن أظلم ممن افترى على الله كذبا وإذ اعتزلتموهم وما يعبدون إلا الله فأووا إلى الكهف ينشر لكم ربكم من رحمته ويهيئ لكم من أمركم مرفقا وترى الشمس إذا طلعت تزاور عن كهفهم ذات اليمين وإذا غربت تقرضهم ذات الشمال وهم في فجوة منه ذلك من آيات الله من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وتحسبهم أيقاظا وهم رقود ونقلبهم ذات اليمين وذات الشمال وكلبهم باسط ذراعيه بالوصيد لو اطلعت عليهم لوليت منهم فرارا ولملئت منهم رعبا وكذلك بعثناهم ليتساءلوا بينهم قال قائل منهم كم لبثتم؟ قالوا لبثنا يوما أو بعض يوم. قالوا ربكم أعلم بما لبثتم فبعثوا أحدكم بورقكم هذه إلى المدينة فلينظر أيها أزكى طعاما فليأتكم برزق منه وليتلطف ولا يشعرن بكم أحدا إنهم إن يظهروا عليكم يرجموكم أو يعيدوكم في ملتهم ولن تفلحوا إذا أبدا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن شاء الله تعالى we are going to begin a new journey today, and this journey that we are going to begin is the journey of Surah Al-Kahf. And as you know, this surah, Surah Al-Kahf, is one of the most read surahs of the Quran, and it's oft-read surahs of the Quran. And as we know, it is encouraged to be read during the day of Friday, and a number of ahadith and have been quoted by the ulama regarding the virtues of this particular surah or the merits of this particular surah. Among those hadith is the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has said, "Man hafidha 10 ayatin min awwal surati al-kahf usima min ad-dajjal." Where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has said, if anyone memorizes the first 10 verses of Suratul Kahf, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him protection from the fitna of ad-dajjal. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that fitna. Because there was no prophet except he used to warn his people against this particular fitna, the fitna of Ad-Dajjal. And this surah, Surah Al-Kahf, and as you can see from the name, which is the cave, Al-Kahf, and Al-Kahf is actually the name given to a cave which is in a mountain and is spacious as well. So it has to be a spacious cave and it has to be in a mountain. So in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's going to talk about, and he's going to tell us like four different stories in the surah. And the first one that we are going to be told is the story of the young men who went to the cave. And also we will be told, inshallah ta'ala, the story of the people of the garden. And we will also be told the story of Prophet Musa alayhi salam and Khidr. And the last story is going to be the story of Dhul Qarnayn. So all these stories are, inshallah ta'ala, going to be mentioned in this amazing surah, Surah Al-Kahf. And like we have said previously, and the Meccans, the Quraysh, they have tried everything possible to stop the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And one of the things that they have done, as we have mentioned previously, is that they have said, after they had a meeting probably, they have said to themselves, we need to send some of our men to Medina, to Yathrib, so we can go and visit the knowledgeable people, the people of the book, the Yahud, and we can ask them if they have any information regarding this particular prophet. And they have sent two men. One of them was another Ibn al-Harith. He was one of the shayateen of Quraysh. Like one of the Mufassirun has said, one of the shayateen of Quraysh was another Ibn al-Harith. Another Ibn al-Harith, one of the things he did was he traveled to Persia in order to learn some of the legends, the stories. And then he came back to Mecca to do what? He used to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He used to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam around. And whenever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam sits with a group of people and he gives them da'wah, as soon as the Prophet leaves, he used to sit with those people. And he used to say to them, the story that I have is better than his story. But that's how he used to talk. So another Ibn al-Harith. Another Ibn al-Harith, and also Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayth. those two guys were very evil men. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he captured them in the battle of Badr, he did not allow them to continue to live. He killed them. Another Ibn al-Harith and Uqbat ibn Abi Mu'ayyid, they were captured like all the other prisoners. But they were the only two men that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not spare them. He said, these two guys, they have to go. Yes. The rest of the prisoners were given the chance to live and pay just a ransom, and that's it. But these two guys, another Ibn al-Harith and Uqbat ibn Abi Mu'ayyid, no, the Prophet said these two guys have to be killed because they were evil people. Another Ibn al-Harith and Uqbah, they went to the Yahud of Yathrib and they have said, what do you know about this man who's claiming to be a prophet? And the Yahud, they have said, you need to go and ask him these three questions. If he answers these three questions, he's a prophet and you should follow him. And if not, he's only just claiming to be a prophet. He's a false prophet and he's not a true prophet. So one of the three questions was regarding the youth of Al-Kahf. So the young men of Al-Kahf, those young men who went to the cave. And also the other one was about Dhul-Qarnayn, who will be mentioned in this surah as well. And the last one is Ar-Ruh, yes, about the soul, which we have already mentioned in Surah Al-Isra. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins this surah with the word Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitaba wa lam yaj'al lahu iwaja. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins with Alhamdulillah. Imam al-Razi rahimahullah ta'ala and has mentioned something which was quite unique, which I have not seen in any other tafsir. He said the previous surah, Surah Al-Isra, what was the first word that Allah began with? Subhan. And in this surah, Allah began with Alhamdulillah. He said, in terms of sequence, always Subhanallah and Alhamdulillah, which one comes first? Subhanallah walhamdulillah. And he said, we can deduce from this, he said, something very important. For something, he said, for something to be able to complete something else, it needs to be complete itself before it actually completes other things. So he said, when you say Subhanallah, you are saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is free from any imperfection. You have to be complete yourself before you complete others. Wow. And he said, that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has used in the previous surah, Subhanalladhi Asra. And now he wants to complete us. And that's why he said, Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitab. Very subtle meaning. And he said, this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he said, Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitaba wa lam yaj'al lahu iwaja. That tells us the Quran is complete, it's perfect. Qayyiman. Now it guides people. لِيُنذِرَ بَأْسًا شَدِيدًا. And he said, similar ayah is, Alif Lam Mim, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. He said, it's like Subhanallah and Alhamdulillah. Subhanallah. Very subtle meaning. He said, Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitab wa lam yaj'al lahu iwaja. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, all the praises and thanks be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has sent down to his slave, Muhammad, the book, the Quran, and has not placed therein any crookedness. قَيِّمًا لِيُنذِرَ بَأْسًا. He has made it straight to give warning to the disbelievers of a severe punishment from him and to give glad tidings to the believers in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Islamic monotheism, who work righteous deeds, that they shall have a fair reward. مَاكِثِينَ فِيهِ أَبَدًا. They shall abide therein forever. A subtle meaning here, مَاكِثِين. When you, خَالِدِينَ and مَاكِثِينَ, they have similar meanings. They shall abide therein forever. If someone stays in a particular place for such a long time, he might become tired of it and bored with it. But the word makithina, it has a meaning with it, a subtle meaning within it. And that subtle meaning is, you will always be anticipating something new. Makithina fihi abada, while they're anticipating what's going to happen next. Imagine now if you buy a new car, that car is gonna satisfy you and make you happy for a while. And then later on, you'll become bored with it and you want to change it. You want to get another car. If you buy a new house, you will be amazed by the house for a few years maybe. And then after that, you become bored of it and you want something better. What makes something exciting is the anticipation. So in paradise, whatever we have, we will be anticipating what is also to come. That's why sometimes children really ask me this difficult question. They say to me, "And Mahalin, if we stay in paradise forever, are we not ever going to get bored?" Yeah, they say that, are we not going to get bored? Like, yes, if you enjoy something for too long, there must be a time where you feel like bored of it. And you say like, why do I need to be here anymore? Do I need to stay in paradise anymore? The beauty of paradise is ما كثينا فيه أبدا. You will always anticipate something new. Yeah, something new is going to happen. Subhanallah. وبشر الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات أن لهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأن كلما رزقوا منها من ثمرة رزقا قالوا هذا الذي رزقنا من قبل وأتوا به متشابها. Yes. Okay. You will, whatever the food you get, the things that you enjoy in paradise, there will always be something new. Okay, you will never get bored of it. Yes, we will never get bored of paradise. We will always enjoy it. Ammar, we will never get bored of paradise. Always we will enjoy paradise because we will be anticipating something new all the time. Something new is going to happen. Every week, what's going to happen in paradise is you become more beautiful than you were the previous week. Subhanallah. Every Friday, you will visit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You'll see Allah and you will come back to your house more beautiful than you were the week before. And your wife will say to you, "You look more beautiful, Ya Ammar. Wow. Yeah, Yasir, you look more beautiful." And what are you going to say to your wife in paradise? "You look even more beautiful than you were the week before." That's exactly what's going to happen. Every week, something amazing is going to happen, you know? So you're not going to be the same. Everything will change, subhanAllah. مَا كِثِينَ فِيهِ أَبَدًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَيُنذِرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا اتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ وَلَدًا. And to warn those who say, Allah has begotten a son. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, وَيُنذِرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا اتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ وَلَدًا مَا لَهُمْ بِهِ مِنْ عِلْمٍ. No knowledge have they of such a thing, nor had they had their fathers. Mighty is the word that comes out of their mouths. That means when they say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had a child, or he had daughters, meaning the angels, they utter nothing but a lie, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, remember when another Ibn al-Harith and Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayyid, when they came back from Medina, and they were given those three questions, they came back to the Meccans and they said to them, now we will be able to challenge Muhammad with these three questions. And if he doesn't answer them, we will definitely know that he is a liar. So when they came to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they said to him, okay, we've got these three questions for you. Do you have answers to them? He said, I will give you the answer by tomorrow. And he didn't say, inshallah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a test, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not reveal anything to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam immediately. It took almost 2 weeks, if not more. And then what happened was, imagine the Meccans kind of like talking to one another and spreading rumors and saying, look, Muhammad, now we caught him. Before he used to lie to us, but now he's absolutely caught. And he hasn't got an answer to our challenge. Just imagine the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hearing that kind of information all the time. Whenever he walks somewhere in Mecca, people say to me, Muhammad, where's the answer? Just imagine the Prophet ﷺ, people approaching him and saying, do you have the answer to those three questions? And the Prophet ﷺ doesn't have any answer to that, to those three questions. It must have been very difficult. And when Angel Jibreel came to him, the Prophet ﷺ said to Angel Jibreel, why didn't you come to me? And why didn't you give me this information previously? Why didn't you come to me and early enough and quickly enough? And then what did Jibreel say to Prophet Muhammad ﷺ? وَمَا نَتَنَزَّلُ إِلَّا بِأَمْرِ رَبِّكَ. We can't just come down and tell you things without the permission of Allah. We only come down with the permission, by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, so even Angel Jibreel didn't have the freedom to just come down and tell Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam things. He was only able to tell him things when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him permission, and also to tell him what he needs to tell Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what happened is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam felt kind of like grieved and so forth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then has said, فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعُ النَّفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمْ إِلَّمْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِهَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَسَفًا. Perhaps you would kill yourself, Ya Muhammad, in grief over their footsteps, for their turning away from you because they believe not in this narration, meaning the Quran. So the Prophet ﷺ felt so sorry for them. Like, he wants to guide them and help them be guided, but they don't want this guidance. They want to go astray. And the Prophet ﷺ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعُ النَّفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِ. Perhaps you would kill yourself, Ya Muhammad, in grief over their footsteps. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا مَا عَلَى الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا لِنَبْلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Verily, we have made that which is on earth as an adornment for it, in order that we may test them, meaning mankind, as to which of them are best in deeds. So whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created on this earth, and whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put inside this earth, it's a test for all of us. لِنَبْلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to see which one of them is good in deeds. And then Allah has said, وَإِنَّا لَجَاعِلُونَ مَا عَلَيْهَا صَعِيدًا جُرُزًا. And verily, we shall make all that is on it, the earth, a bare dry soil one day without any vegetation. And this is kind of like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is setting up the stories that he's about to mention. So this is like an introduction, like a set. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just setting up the introduction to what he's about to tell us about the stories that are about to come. أَمْ حَسِبْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, do you think that the people of the cave and the inscription were a wonder among our signs? That's the question Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked. أَمْ حَسِبْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ. Do you think that the people of the cave and the inscription were a wonder among our signs? What will come next to be continued. The stories will begin tomorrow, inshallah ta'ala. Today was just like a quick introduction. And please do not forget, where's Brother Jibril? Please do not forget to give your condolences to our beautiful brother Abu Ammar. Where is he? Yes, he's just over here, mashallah. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Here is the brother Jibril, mashallah. Jazakumullah khair.